recordar los años 20 ahora.
Havana, Cuba. It's a place that captivates your imagination, full of wonder and full of mystery. I've been coming here as a journalist for 20 years, and I've been passionate about Cuban cigars even longer. We all know there's something very special about Cuban cigars, but exactly why are they so unique? What is it that makes them the best in the world? Is it because the tobacco is better? The climate? The factories? Cigars are made in lots of other countries, but as good as they can be, they aren't as wonderful as the cigars made in Cuba. I've been thinking about these questions lately, so I thought it was time to find the answers once and for all. My first stop was the Casa del Habano in Havana, a cigar shop run by one of the great Cuban tabaqueros, Enrique Mons. Enrique has been in the cigar business a very long time, since he was a teenager. If anyone could start me off on the right track, it would be him.
¿Qué trae como consecuencia? Por otro lado, tú ves la isla. La isla tiene tabaco en Oriente, en Camagüey, en Las Villas. Y están experimentando en otros sitios. Pero ninguno lo puede comparar con el de Pinar del Río. Que son franjas de tierra, no es todo Pinar del Río. Son franjas de tierra que existen en la zona de Pinar del Río.
Sí, dicen Vega Fina.
Vega Fina. Y te puedes encontrar ya Vega Fina a partir de Pinar del Río hacia allá. San Juan de Martínez, San Vicente y San Luis, que son la meca.
So I took Enrique's advice and went to the source. The next morning, my video crew and I went to the province about 2.5 hours west of Havana, called Pinar del Río. Specifically to a small town in Pinar called San Juan y Martínez. It's a beautiful place and stunningly rustic. In some ways, it's like going back in time, but that's Cuba. So many things are like that here, living moments of history unfolding right before your eyes. But most importantly, this is where the tobacco is. Field after field of it. It's a sight that's breathtaking for any passionate cigar smoker. Seeing these tobacco fields is what it must have been like for Dorothy when she first saw the Emerald City. For cigar smokers, Pinar del Río is our Emerald City. As my video crew and I drove through the area, we passed a beautiful tobacco farm on the highway that caught my eye. So I thought I'd stop and see if I could talk to the owner. I wasn't exactly sure why I wanted to stop, but I had a hunch there was something for me to learn there.
We're in the holy grail of tobacco, just outside the town of San Juan y Martínez. This is one of the towns where top tobacco comes from, what they call Vega Fina. That means top farms or fine farms where the best tobacco is grown. Here we have tobacco that's already been picked, so you can see it's in flowering, meaning it's done. Even the tobacco leaves at the top, those aren't going to be used. Behind me is tobacco that's still growing. It hasn't even been picked yet. Cubans do this because they want to stagger the growing. So some of the tobacco is already in the barn, while others is growing at the same time. This is important too because you have changes in weather, and it's sort of an insurance policy for the growers.
This grower's name is Diego Comacho Castillo. He was busy with the harvest when I arrived unannounced, but like all Cubans, he was very gracious about it. He gave us complete access to his beautiful farm and allowed us to shoot some video.
We're at the Finker farm of Provenir, just outside San Juan y Martínez. They're picking sun-grown tobacco, picking the bottom part of the plant. There's actually 5 levels, so they're picking, really, it's like a pre-selection. Each level they put together and then they transport over to the tobacco barns. So this is the process. It's, you can see how labor-intensive it is. And these two guys do all the work here. It's a family farm. They do everything. The mother's in the drying barn, as well as the wife. And this is the heart and soul of Cuban tobacco.
I wanted to ask Diego some questions about his life, but he hardly ever stopped working while we were there. Finally, I got him to stop for a minute.
Bueno, aquí en mi casa vivimos, siempre hemos sido tres personas. Mi papá y yo, que soy único hijo. Entonces, bueno, él faltó, pero bueno, después yo me casé, tengo mi esposa. Por suerte tuvo dos niños, Jimagua, gemelos los dos, que ustedes lo pueden ver. Y bueno, ahora somos cinco de familia, una familia muy linda, que yo quiero mucho y que son mi vida. Y me ayudan aquí en las labores y lo que... En todo lo que ellos puedan me ayudan. Y llevamos una familia muy unida. Muy unida, muy unida.
Diego is a hard-working, dedicated tobacco farmer. But he's a low-key man of very few words. His mother, on the other hand, quite the opposite.
No, 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 son fotos, video.
Sí, sí. Pero crees que yo no conozco. Yo conozco más que eso. Esta finquita es de mi esposo. Era de mi esposo, era. Ya él falleció. Entonces, que al tener un solo hijo, él decía que iba a estudiar o no iba a estudiar, que yo le diera la opinión que yo creyera. Que él se dedicó a él, a llevarlo a La Habana, a tenerlo en La Habana y todo. A los 8 meses falleció. Entonces, dice ahora él, mima, ¿qué hago yo? ¿Qué tú crees que yo pueda hacer? Digo, le niño, quedarte con nosotros. Primero porque estaba Diego enfermo y después, cuando él terminó los estudios principales. Y después, estar aquí con nosotros, que es lo que queremos, tenerte a ti siempre. Dice, bueno, no se habla más nada. Se acabó el estudio y vengo para La Veguita a cuidar a Pipo y a estar con Pipo. Pero él estaba enfermo y se murió. Falleció. Entonces se ha quedado al frente de esto, mira. De La Veguita, que es toda de nosotros. Yo tengo que vivir mirándolo a él como era con mi esposo. Él me dice, mima, no me cuides tanto, mima, no me cuides. Pero yo, ¿a quién voy a cuidar? ¿A quién yo voy a cuidar si no es a él? Si para mí eres lo más grande que pueda tener en la vida. Y ahora tengo, esta es la esposa de él, mira. La esposa de él. Y me dieron un tesoro en la vida. Un par de gemelos. Los niños tienen 10 años, ya están así. Ya tengo dos más, son tres hijos ahora. Esos niños los quiero con la vida. Viste, de tanto que los quiero, hasta sentimiento me da. Mira si los quiero. Bueno, ¿para qué?
No, gracias. Ay. Fuerte, muy fuerte, gracias. Gracias. This is how it begins. Tiny little seeds, almost like speckles of sand.
These seeds are first planted in nurseries. After about 35 days, they're 6 to 8 inches high and ready to be replanted into the tobacco fields. Field workers carefully pick the small plants out of the ground, one at a time. It's back-breaking work, but then again, everything about growing tobacco is physically demanding. When they've picked 100 seedlings, they shake the excess dirt off the roots and then tie them into bunches. The bunches are left in the field so the workers can continue their picking, and then later collected and put into piles. Workers must get the seedlings to the permanent field within a few hours, or they will die. The seedlings are carefully carried out to be replanted in the very fertile soil of the tobacco field. Cuban soil. There's nothing like it anywhere else on Earth.
It's this that makes Cuban tobacco so special. Many other things, but it's this that you find in Cuba, in Pinar del Rio, in Vega Finas. That makes the difference.
Before the seedlings are replanted, the soil is plowed into deep furrows. After that, a foreman passes out the bunches of seedlings to a large team of workers known as vigueros. And the replanting begins. The soil has already been irrigated and its chemical composition analyzed to determine what nutrients are lacking and need to be replenished. The vigueros place the seedlings into the moist earth about 12 to 15 inches apart. There's nothing automated about this process, just men and hands and the iron and copper-rich red soil that's unique to Cuba. It can take up to 10 days to plant a standard-sized tobacco field of 20 acres. After the planting comes a light plowing to loosen the earth, followed a number of days later by the application of fertilizer, which is typically a combination of nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, and magnesium. All the while, the plants are carefully tended, including hoeing to keep the soil loose and to allow for optimum growth. As José Martí, the great Cuban poet, said, a tobacco grower must care for each plant as if it were a delicate maiden. In these ideal conditions, the tobacco thrives.
This is sun-grown tobacco after 20 days in the soil. Look how quickly it's grown, but it still has double that to go.
The tobacco continues to grow to maturity over the next 20 days, until what was once nothing more than a brown field of earth is now a dark green carpet of, well, of heaven.
So I'm with these growers, and they have their sun tobacco, and these two guys are doing it all on their own, all the tobacco you can see. They've started picking today. The tobacco is ready to pick. So they pick, they picked up to here, and they're gonna go all the way through the field and picking themselves, just two of them. Then they come back and they'll pick to here and go through. Then they'll come back, they'll pick the top part. Because the difference is below, it's lighter, less thick tobacco. The higher you go up on the plant, the thicker and richer it is. More nicotine, more everything. So that's how they do it. Then it goes into the barns and they dry it. This is sun-grown tobacco that goes in the filler.
The tobacco, which provides the four or five leaves that are planted into a cigar's filler, is picked by hand in six passages, each of which takes about 7 days. The harvest goes from the bottom up, and each pass removes only two or three leaves. About 120 days will have passed from the replanting of the seedlings to the end of the harvest, and during this time, each plant will have been examined on average 170 times. Once the tobacco leaves are harvested, they are taken to the curing barns nearby to start the drying process. But there's another kind of tobacco that goes into the making of a cigar besides the filler. It's the wrapper tobacco, and it requires special cultivation. It's grown under a cheesecloth tenting called tapado. The netting diffuses the sunlight on the leaves, so they grow wider and thinner for the all-important wrapper tobacco.
We have the different levels of the plants where they actually pick leaf by leaf. The libre pie is already done. Now we have the remedio, Ligero uno, ligero dos, gordo y corona. They'll go each one, one by one, when they're ready.
The shade-grown tobacco typically has the same growth rate as the sun-grown, maturing in about 45 days. And just like the sun-grown, the leaves are removed in stages from bottom to top. A typical mature plant yields about 16 leaves, and since each leaf is eventually split into two, technically the plant could provide enough leaves for 32 cigar wrappers. But usually only six or seven are good enough for a Cuban cigar. The others are usually used for binder or filler. The best wrappers come from the middle part of the plant. However, Maduro wrappers often come from the leaves at the top of the plant.
And what's left now is just the corona, the top of the leaf. That makes the many of the darker cigars like the Limitadas. And you can see the workers there are picking the very last leaves, and it's gonna make a rich, spicy, beautiful cigar.
Soon the harvest will be done, and the agricultural part of a cigar's evolution will be finished.
It's sort of sad, but it's over. It's been harvested. This was shade-grown tobacco. No more tents. Done. It looks like this. They'll just roll it over into the soil, and it'll be ready for next year.
The harvested tobacco leaves are next taken to curing barns that are aligned east to west so that the sun warms one end of the shed in the morning and the other in the afternoon. Inside the barn, women string the leaves in pairs onto big needles that are then hung on long wooden poles. The poles are placed on horizontal supports and the leaves are left to dry. It takes about 7 weeks. First, the leaves turn from green to yellow, and then through the oxidation process, the real magic happens, and they take on that beautiful golden brown color.
We're in the drying barn of a sun-grown tobacco farm near San Juan y Martinez. This tobacco is almost done. The total process is between 30 and 45 days. So it takes that long to go from green to this beautiful brown. But if you feel it, ay, graso, you can even see the oil coming out of the leaf. See it coming out of my finger?
It was time for me to visit the greatest tobacco plantation in the world, Finca Alejandro Robaina. Alejandro Robaina was the godfather of Cuban tobacco, and I hadn't been to the plantation since he passed away, so I was feeling very sad as I drove up.
I'm here at the tobacco farm of Alejandro Robaina. I haven't been here for about a year, but it's gonna be strange for me to walk up that road and greet his family, because Alejandro's been dead now for very close to a year, and it's gonna be hard for me because, you know, he was really like my Cuban grandfather, and I learned a lot about tobacco from him, as well as life. And I learned how actually the greatness of Cuban cigars is only great as the family who actually grow tobacco behind them. So for me, it's gonna be a tough day, but you know, I'm looking forward to seeing Hiroshi's grandson and seeing how the farm is doing. And I know that Alejandro was very proud of what his family was doing with the farm, especially his grandson. So I'm gonna go see what's going on. What's this?
Toby.
Bien, gracias.
Chava.
Qué extraño sin Alejandro.
Qué extraño, muy extraño. Hay un vacío.
Sí.
Alejandro was more than just a tobacco grower. He was an inspiration to all who were lucky enough to know him. He was as soulful a man as I've ever met. And I'll always remember how he treated me like a son whenever I came to visit. Some men are never forgotten. Hiroshi worked and studied with Alejandro for 14 years, learning all the secrets of the master. Now that he's fully in charge of the plantation, he's dedicated himself to maintaining the highest standards and keeping the monumental legacy of his grandfather alive. But Hiroshi is a young man and wants to adapt to the modern world. One of the new techniques he's put into place is a system to control the temperature and humidity in the curing barns for a much more precise control of the drying process.
This is interesting because they have one of their traditional curing barns, but actually they've added a controlling system which controls the humidity and the heat, the temperature inside. So it's always stable, controlled, and works all the time, which is a good thing, no, Roshi?
Sí, sí, sí. Fíjate, lo que te explicaba. Esta es la temperatura que hay dentro de la cámara. Ahora mismo hay 29 grados. Esa es la esa temperatura cool. Existe realmente.
So that's how warm it is inside the barn.
Y la humedad.
And the humidity?
86%.
As it's drying, they reduce the humidity and maintain the heat. So as Hiroshi was telling me earlier in an interview, that it's controlled, it's not artificial. It's actually natural, but controlled. I'm now inside the curing barn, and you can see the tobacco changing color. At first it was green, fresh out of the tapado, out of the area it was grown. It was picked, brought in here, and it's drying, and it's going to turn to a perfectly brown, light brown color. Entonces, ¿cuántos días para estar?
Para que termine el proceso, sí. 30 días.
So it's 30 days to end it. So eso es un poco más rápido que natural, que sin este sistema.
Ajá, un poquito más rápido, pero sí. Solamente hay una diferencia de 15 días.
Sí, it's only a difference of 15 days. Pero si controla, también todo es más uniforme, ¿no?
Claro.
It's more uniform by doing it this way.
Lo que pasa es que está muy seco, ¿eh? Pero esto lo cogen en la fábrica, hacen esta operación aquí, cogen aquí, ¿eh? Ellos cogen aquí, sacan el nervio central, ahí tienes tu tabaco.
Gracias.
Aquí.
I'm now in the traditional barn where the tobacco, the wrapper tobacco, has been drying for about 45, 50 days. You can see that the color is a little bit darker than the controlled style, and also the leaf's actually drier. So Hiroshi was telling me that he thinks that the controlled way, the modern way, is better because it has better humidity, they lose less tobacco from here to the fermentations, and the color's better, and it's thinner and finer. I think he's right. We're in one of their casa de tabaco, their drying barns, and they already have some of their wrapper tobacco, which is going through the first fermentation. You can see it here in what they call pilon, which are, you know, it's about waist height. It's fermenting away. It's gonna ferment like this for about 30 days. And this fermentation process actually stabilizes the color and takes away a lot of the impurities like high levels of nicotine, ammonia, and other things. It's put in these little hands of about 50 leaves. You can see they're all together. You can see the quality of the tobacco. Look how beautiful it is. You can see the oil and the little sort of pimples on it. That's richness, that's flavor, that's nicotine. Beautiful tobacco this year. Well, what happens after this is, after the fermentation, it's transported in paper or carton boxes to another warehouse outside of here where all the growers put them, and they do the secondary fermentation, which is longer, 50 days, and it makes it even more refined and takes away even more impurities. And finally, that tobacco is sorted by color and texture and sent to Havana for rolling or other places.
As much as he dedicates himself to the plantation, Hiroshi is still a father and a member of the community. So every so often he likes to take a break and walk over to the school his grandfather helped build next to the plantation to see his daughters.
Light, ven acá. Ven acá, Light. Profe, ¿cómo está portando la niña? ¿Te está portando bien, Light? ¿Están haciendo caso a la maestra?
Un besito, papá.
Lau, dame el besito mío de por la mañana. El besito mío de por la mañana. Mi princesita linda. Daniela, mi sobrina. Esta es la sobrina más linda de mí.
The school was built in 1971 and is named after Ruben Martinez Villena, who was an important Cuban writer.
¿Cómo te está portando? ¿Cómo está portando el net? Bien, bien. Oye, ¿qué portaste bien?
Men like Orochi are guardians of the past, but they're also custodians of the future. Hiroshi's goals are to be true to the great traditions of Cuban tobacco, and at the same time, prepare for and embrace what is ahead. His grandfather would be proud. It was time to bid farewell to Finca Robina. So we headed to the town of San Diego de los Baños. San Diego de los Baños is a charming little town of less than 2,000 people. It's like a lot of towns in Cuba, men playing a lively game of dominoes in the park, uniformed students taking a break from classes. The town is most famous for its health resort, but I didn't come to relax in the mineral baths. I was there to visit the Escuida, one of the many provincial sorting houses where the tobacco from the farms goes through a careful selection process as well as second fermentation before it goes to the factories in Havana.
This big mound of tobacco has come from different growers. This is one grower. It's already been fermented in his curing barn, and it's waiting to be moistened, which will happen tomorrow morning. After the moistening, the tobacco is deveined and selected and then put into piles for fermenting. ¿Puedes explicar un poco qué esta muchacha hace ahora?
Esta muchacha, como usted dice, está seleccionando las distintas clases de tabaco. Se seleccionan por el tamaño de la hoja, el estado físico. ¿Ve? En distintas clases. Tiene las tripas. ¿Tres tripas, Mayr?
Dos
tripas y tres capotes.
Ah, también capote.
Capote también. Wow. Son cinco clases. ¿Ve?
Wow.
Y la picadura, que es para la cigarrería.
Sí.
La misma que te hablaba.
Y la selección es para textura, fortaleza,
sí.
Y tamaño.
Y tamaño, sí.
Y después este
va al proceso,
sí,
de fermentación.
Sí.
Ajá, son los pilones.
¿Y cuántas hojas una persona puede seleccionar para el día?
Hojas específicas nosotros se las damos por libra. No. Tiene que ser 13 libras.
Ah, 13 libras. Ah,
13
okay.
Libras. Es la norma, sí. Diaria de cada compañía.
This is the secondary fermentation in pilón, or in piles here. ¿Y cuánto tiempo hace esta fermentación?
De 45 a 60 días.
Y la diferencia en tiempo es una pregunta de la fortaleza de tabaco, ¿no?
De la clase, ajá.
La clasificación.
Hay tabaco que procesan primero que otro.
Entonces, por ejemplo, ligero es más fuerte.
Más fuerte.
Entonces, ese dura más tiempo.
Más tiempo para fermentar.
Y más suave es volado.
Volado.
Este,
menos tiempo.
Entonces, 40 días.
30 a 35 días.
Entonces, ¿la temperatura debe estar cuánto para hacer una buena fermentación?
De 42 a 45 grados de temperatura. Él sube a 45 grados de temperatura y se mantiene.
Uh-huh.
Alrededor de 15, 16, 17 días. Luego retrocede. Cuando esté en 37, 38. Acto para exportar.
¿Qué hace exactamente la fermentación?
Es quien le da el proceso al tabaco.
Entonces, disminuye la nicotina, yes. Amoniac, todas las cosas todas malas.
Ajá, lo elimina porque está, tiene fiebre, está fermentando. Uh-huh. Está eliminando todo eso y está poniéndose el tabaco en un estado óptimo para exportar.
Y todo está natural, ¿no?
Todo es natural. Agua solamente.
No cambia nada para 100, 200 años.
No. Agua.
Bueno.
Natural todo.
This is tobacco that's going to the factories. One of 50. Havana, Holguín, Villa Clara. But the tobacco has already been classified, fermented, everything. It's ready to go. This could be folado, seco, ligero. And then they all have their different classifications. So it's ready to go. It's shipped to a central warehouse outside of Havana, for example, and then it's shipped to the different factories. But it's ready to be rolled. All they'll have to do is wet it, classify it a little bit more, figure out the blend, and make the cigars. I'm here in the La Corona factory in Havana. Behind me are bales of tobacco, wrapper leaf, that have been done in royal palm leaves. It's brought here, then these gentlemen take the tobacco out and loosen the hands of leaves to prepare it to be moistened. After it's moistened, the tobacco is left for 24 hours, and after that it goes to the galera to be rolled. This moistening makes the leaves elastic. That's how they can roll it.
The moistening process is one of the few parts of a cigar's journey where machines are used. Workers carefully fan the tobacco out like a flower and then place each bunch into a carousel. Once all the carousels are full, the chamber is sealed and the machine is turned on. The carousels turn slowly as the tobacco is lightly misted with water. Afterwards, the bunches are hung up overnight so that the humidity can distribute itself evenly along the leaf. The next day, the now elastic tobacco leaves are ready to be classified.
I'm here in the La Corona factory in Havana. I'm in the disparillo section. This is where the women take the wrapper. They destem it and they classify it by texture, color, and size. Size is the most important thing because they have anywhere from 12 to 25 different sizes. And it can be anything from Petite Corona, Robusto, Double Corona, or even larger.
Destemming is done differently depending on the ultimate use of the leaf. One quarter of the central vein is removed for the filler, half is removed for the binder, and the entire vein is removed for the wrapper. Next, the tobacco is separated into specific classifications and weighed in preparation for the very secretive blending of each cigar brand and size. Everything is very precise and done with great care.
This is the blending room. These women are actually classifying the capote or the binder of the cigar. They use four classifications according to size. But earlier they were actually making the blends of the different sizes of cigars or vitolas and also the brands. They use three tobaccos or tripa, and that's the volado for the combustion, the seco for the aromas and flavor, and the ligero for the strength. Those blends are done first by size, Promiente, which is the name used in the rolling room for Double Corona, Pyramid, or number two Torpedo, and that's first done, and then they slightly tweak it with the ligero and seco for the different brands. Those ligeros and secos are classified according to where they come from in Pinar del Rio and by the strength. I'm now in the blending room. The blends have been made by size. Each container can make up to 1,000 cigars. And the tobacco is left in here for 48 hours before it goes up to the rolling room. Each container is a different size and contains the filler, which is volado, seco, and ligero tobaccos. I'm in the blending room of the factory, and what he's doing right now is he's putting together bundles of blends for double coronas. Each little packet is for 50 cigars. That's given to the roller. The roller will normally go through two of those packets a day.
This is the galera, or rolling room, and it's the heart of each factory. The person you can hear is the lector, whose job is to read to the rollers while they work. Traditionally, the rollers would give the lector a small part of their daily pay to entertain and educate them throughout the day. While the lector reads, the rollers, or torcedores as they're called, turn leaves of tobacco into about 100 perfect Cuban cigars per day. First, three different types of filler tobacco are put together in accordance with the specific blend of that brand, piece by piece. Then that filler is rolled into leaves of binder tobacco, two or three, depending on the size of the cigar. What may look like a rather imprecise process is quite the contrary, due to the very skillful hands of each roller. Even so, it's more of an art than a science, and each cigar is a little different than any other. Once the binder and filler have been rolled together, the roller puts the bunch into a wooden or plastic mold. Then those molds are placed into a manual press. During the 45 minutes or so of the pressing process, the cigars are rotated to create an even contour. The objective here is to press the cigar into a perfect cylindrical shape before the wrapper is finally put on. But there's even one more step before that happens.
I'm in the quality control now. These machines are checking the draw of the bunches. They're checking this before they actually put the wrapper on the cigar. So now you're not gonna have any problems with those cigars not drawing, which is a big problem from about 1998 to 2001. The people check between 40 and 80% of the production.
Next is the final part of the rolling process, putting on the wrapper. The roller chooses each wrapper leaf with great care based on color, texture, and shine. The wrapper is trimmed on both sides with a semi-circular blade called a civetta to sculpt it into the optimum shape for wrapping the cigar. Then the bunch is laid at an angle across the wrapper, which is then stretched as necessary and wound carefully around the binder, overlapping at each turn. In this case, the torpedo shape must be finished with a very fine point. The excess wrapper is trimmed, and dabs of tasteless vegetable gum are applied as adhesive. The tip is then finished off very carefully by hand. The end is guillotined to size, and the cigar is rolled with the flat part of the steel blade to make sure its construction is even. The finished cigars then go through a rigorous quality control process. They're checked to make sure they've been rolled properly, to make sure they're the proper ring gauge, and to make sure they're the proper length.
I'm in the Escoida. These cigars are being color sorted. There's 64 different classifications for color, and this is all done to make sure that all the cigars in a box have a uniform color.
This is a gooey job and someone's got to do it. I mean, it must be horrible every day trying to get your hands apart. But they do 300 boxes a day like that when they're decorating them, whether it's Partagas, Bolivar, or whatever, in the wooden boxes that have paper on top of them.
Boxes have been made like this since the mid-1800s, when banker H. Upman had the idea to send cigars to London in ornamental sealed boxes instead of in bundles. The art of decorative box making was created by artist Ramon Aliones, who has a cigar brand named after him. Before they go into these boxes, each Cuban cigar is branded with its unique brand name. There was a time that cigars in cabinet boxes were not banded, but that changed in 2006, and now all Cuban cigars have bands. The cigars are then packaged into flat, shallow boxes, or tied into bundles and put into square cabinet boxes. Here, a cabinet of 25 are first carefully arranged into an octagonal bundle and then tied with a satin ribbon. One last adjustment to make sure that the bands on the outer cigars squarely face the person who's looking at them. And then the cigars are gently placed into the cedar box. Cedar is used because it helps the cigars from drying out and furthers the maturing process. For flat boxes of 25, the envasador separates the cigars into two groups that will form the upper and lower layers of the cigar box. He will meticulously arrange each layer of cigars, darkest to lightest, from left to right. Then the cigars are put into their box with their best side facing up. It's all done to stay true to the color arrangement and to deliver the ideal presentation to the consumer.
So right here, they're putting on the code for the factory. Each box has the date when the cigars were put in and actually the code at the top. The funny story is that actually I was one of the first to break that story almost 20 years ago. And finally, after 10, 15 years, they decided, you know what? We're gonna start putting the code on the box. We still don't know the code all the time of the factory because that changes, let's say, from every 3 to 6 months. But all the time you can read the date. And obviously this is February 2011. And the great thing is they do it by hand.
These cigars have gone through more than 200 pairs of hands and undergone almost 140 stages of processing. What a journey. But it's not over yet. Now they're boxed up and shipped to retail outlets all around the world. Can't wait to get some of those myself. So when I got back to Havana, I decided to visit one of those retail outlets. The Casa del Habano is inside a beautiful hotel called Conde de Villanueva. Villanueva is a small hotel built around an open courtyard, complete with its own peacock. The Casa del Habano is up the wooden stairs on the second floor, overlooking the courtyard. Oh, how many times I've been down this narrow walkway. It's a wonderful old shop with lots of character. Not to mention an excellent inventory of all the great Cuban cigar brands. Enough to excite even the most jaded cigar smokers. It was time for me to have a cigar and a chat with the manager of the shop, Reynaldo Jimenez. Reynaldo started as a factory roller and rose in the ranks to become the manager of one of the best shops in Havana. So over a cup of strong coffee and a glass of rum, I asked Reynaldo why he thought Cuban cigars were so very, very special.
Mira, para ti, ¿cómo tabaco, o por qué tabaco cubano para ti es el mejor en el mundo?
El tabaco cubano para mí es mejor del mundo, porque Cuba es el único capaz de fabricar el tabaco con 100% madera prima cubana. Es decir, que tiene todo lo que es la tripa, el capote y la capa cubana. Tenemos también una, por decirlo así, una gracia de Dios, que tenemos un microclima en Pinar del Río único en el mundo, donde el tabaco se da con un sabor, una fortaleza, un aroma diferente. Puedes llevarte la semilla para Dominicana, para Nicaragua, y la siembras y no, nunca va a coger el aroma y la fortaleza que tiene este tabaco, este sabor que es diferente, que lo distingue. Siendo un tabaco de otro origen, y no es que sea malo, pero el aroma es diferente, el sabor. Uno se da cuenta enseguida que no es un habano, que es solamente es un tabaco.
I knew what he was talking about, and he was right, of course. Cuban cigars do taste different than other cigars. And when you realize just how much care goes into producing a Cuban cigar, it's not hard to understand why they're the best in the world. But is that it? Cuban cigars are great because they come from a unique microclimate and they're made really well? Maybe that's the logical explanation, but it wasn't enough for me. There had to be something else. So I decided to go to the top and visit Jorge Maike, the new co-president of Habanos S.A., the Havana-based distribution and marketing company for Cuban cigars worldwide. Jorge Maike is one of the smartest men in the cigar business, and his knowledge of growing tobacco, making cigars, and all the processes in between is vast. I wanted to get his perspective on what makes Cuban tobacco and Cuban cigars so magical.
Tobacco is history, but it's a tradition as well. I mean, when you work for tobacco, it's like something special is coming inside, you know? It's in your blood, you know? It's part of your life, it's part of I mean, people who work for Habanos, for tobacco in general, we are happy. Because we're happy, because we love what we do. And we wake up every day, we wake up and say, I'm happy, because I'm going to do something that I love. And we are lucky. People who work for Habanos are lucky people, because we're working for something we love. On the top, if you love to smoke a very good Habanos, it's perfect. Because you have pleasure, work, everything together. You people like Alejandro Robaina, or the others, they work up to the age of 90, 95, 95 years old. Even they were sitting at home. They couldn't walk, but they walk only to see the tobacco plantation, just to feel the smell, just to touch the tobacco leaf. What it means? Passion. Because it's the leitmotiv, you know? Just walk to see what you have been creating for years, for many, many years. For us, it's like a religion.
I'd hoped Jorge would give me some ultimate insight, and he did. The answer was right in front of me every day. As I thought about my journey, the most powerful memories were of the people I met along the way. I remember their passion. I remember their hard work and dedication. And I remember their joy. It was now clear to me that this was a case where the qualities of the producer actually get into the product. I realized that in the end, they are the product, and the product is them. So after 5 days of traveling from Pinar del Rio to the Malecon in Havana, I think I finally figured it out. I figured out what makes cigars the heart and soul of Cuba.
It's been an amazing journey. I'm thinking about why Cuban cigars are so great. It's a lot of reasons. It's the soil, it's the climate, it's the tobacco, but most important, it's the people.